Hello and welcome to Hot Issues, sponsored by the nation's builder, Gassem Cement. This week, we are taking a look at a topic that it's normally discussed around everywhere. We're going to look at sports, its various divisions, football, basketball, lawn tennis, boxing, everything about football. And then also, we shall take a look at the administration and administrators of football. We'll probably take a look into the Ministry of Youth and Sports. What is it in that ministry that makes it possible to have such a high turnout of ministers? Welcome to Hot Issues. Hello, welcome back to Hot Issues, the program which is sponsored by the nation's builders, Gassem Cement. And as I indicated from the beginning, we're going to take a look at sports, sports administration, we're going to take a look at players, and we're going to take a look at managers. Where is Ghana sports today and where are we likely to go? What is happening in the various departments of sports? And we are perhaps privileged to have with us in the studio the minister himself, Honorable Nelante Vanderpoel. So you're welcome to the studio.
Thank you very much, sir.
Yes, sir. Now, generally, what does sports look like in the country? What is the general situation of sports today?
Well, I would say it's that of mixed sentiments. Mixed sentiments because certain disciplines have had, let me say, a low turn of public interest and public attraction and public, sympathy. And certain sporting disciplines are also now attracting public interest. If we take football, after what happened in Brazil, a lot of Ghanaians have become a bit worried about the future of our football, how it is managed, and the sort of things we do with our football. That to some extent has affected low morale, has affected attendance at national team matches and the rest. But when you take a sport like boxing, we've seen all of a sudden some interest growing up in boxing. If you take swimming, a lot more Ghanaians are becoming interested in swimming. People are ready to take their children for swimming lessons. A lot more swimming centers are being opened up, the same with weightlifting, the same with some of the other lesser known disciplines. So I would say Ghana sports have prospects if we can shift a little bit more attention from the traditional sports, being football, boxing, and maybe to some extent athletics, to the other lesser known disciplines like swimming, weightlifting, volleyball, beach soccer, even golf. Golf is today receiving so much attraction, so much attention. From discussions, it's possible Ghana could stand a position of one of these days having Ghana Open or Accra Open, which will attract all the known golfers across. So, in a way, let me say, our sports has prospects, but some other sporting disciplines will have to rebrand themselves in order to get back the attraction they used to have, which they, to some extent, have lost.
Let's stay with football. I mean, recently there were issues about our national coach. A claim that he doesn't stay in Ghana, and that Ghana had become a holiday resort for him. As minister, did this come to your attention? What's your reaction?
Well, that's a very interesting issue. Let me first concede that hitherto I didn't know the contents of the agreement which was signed between the GFA and the coach. But I believe whatever it is, at the end of it all, Ghanaians are paying him to get something out of him. And as such, we should look at his performance and look at whether we are getting what we desire. I believe in paying a national team coach for that amount of money at that time, as I saw it, wasn't just a matter of paying him to take care of the Black Stars. And if you look at the way the Black Stars operate, a lot of majority go to close to 99% of our players outside. And as such, if the coach is going to go around the country monitoring them, then it doesn't really make, we are not getting value for money. My interest is that if we are paying that amount of money for an expatriate, then there must be transfer of knowledge, transfer of technology to other people so that we'll benefit from it. So my contention was that even if the players were outside the country, the coach could stay in here, run a lot of clinics for some of our local coaches so that they can tap something from him. Then we'll be giving a great value for the amount of money we're paying. I expressed my indignation about it. And initially, the coach didn't understand me, but later on, he came to appreciate it. And one of the things I was seeing is that in order to give an impetus to urge that Ghanaian local player, the one in our domestic league, to do more than himself, was to see the coach attending some of our matches, and his presence alone will be able to lift up the spirit of that player, so that maybe if he plays well, the coach will notice him. So I felt that if we're going to have attraction, we are going to have high level of performance in the players and the management and the technical people in our local football, then the coach must be present. If a coach should come to a match between, let's say, Accra, Suffolk and Techiman City, and the coach is there, the coach can note some of the lapses in the technical play of the two teams and draw that particular coach's attention to those things. And I'm happy the coach later on saw my point, came over, we had a discussion, and since then, well, I think we're all seeing the results of his staying here, going through our league centers, noting some of our local players, having interaction with some of our local coaches, and I think Ghana football will be the best for it.
Basic question, who pays the coach?
I believe Ghana. Ghana as a country pays the coach.
Are you sure?
Yes, because if the coach is being paid from monies that we get from sponsorship, every sponsorship money, once it's a Ghanaian company which is sponsoring, is tax loss to government. Mm-hmm. So it's not free money. So
yeah, but who is donating this money which is paying the coach?
The GMPC.
GMPC.
Yeah, GMPC. Mm. So if GMPC money is paying the coach, then in effect it is Ghana which is paying the coach.
What about the argument that Ghana has people who can coach the national team and that we don't need to bring foreign coaches?
I totally agree with those people. I totally agree. The best of our achievements as a nation have been under Ghanaian coaches. The late Ben Kofi is an example. Late CK Jemfi is an example. Coach Ade, the late Samuel Jose Atukefio, all of them.
Even Kwesi Appiah.
Even Kwesi Appiah. Yeah. And so I think that Okwai, for example, I think that the Ghanaian, I always ask myself, what is it that is in the brains, in the genes of that white man that is not in the black man? And a lot of our players have performed better than some of these expatriates we've seen around. What we need maybe is investing a little bit more in them for them to be abreast with the trends. And with Ghanaian players, what I have said, and people have criticized me for it, is that for my the little football knowledge I've played, as somebody who played football, at the level of the national team, the Black Stars, whatever the coach teaches them is just about 5% of whatever they know. Because these players are already stars in their own right. So it's the team's organization, the psychological build-up, and the general appreciation of what is ahead of them that the coach needs to put in. So few technical bits that he puts together in order to achieve the result. And normally, from what I know, as soon as the whistle goes, sometimes all those pep talks in the dressing room and things become very useless. Because the game could change. And when it changes, the players will have to adapt to the changes. And some of the players are so clever and so intelligent that on the field of play, they are able to change situations and conditions in order to respond effectively to what is coming from the other side. So the coach's work is very important. The coach's work is needed. But I would say at the level of the senior national team, for example, I don't believe that we definitely need an expatriate in order to achieve. If anything at all, I can say that we need Ghanaian coaches who we can support in order to add value to themselves, in order to perform just as an expatriate would do. So I believe I'm one of the apostles of the belief that local coaches could make us achieve more.
Yeah, the president talks about patronizing what is Ghanaian. You are a minister, you believe in local coaches. Many people have said the same, but we are still importing coaches. How come?
Let me say, a lot of
what
people...
What is the problem? What does it mean that does not enable us to do what we say? The problem has to do with
the Ghanaian. The Ghanaian always have that feeling that something from outside is better than what you have. And I don't know, because I don't share that opinion. I'm from a background, I've also been through difficult situations with people who have come from other places, and I think I've shown level of excellence as pertaining to my performance in those areas. And I believe that when you give the Ghanaian opportunity, he will be able to rise to the occasion just as anybody from any part of the globe will do. What we have done is that we've not value, we not cherish our own. Scripturally, it said that a prophet is without honor in his own country. And I believe that is what we've taken to the ultimate. I believe somebody like Kwesi Appiah was a wonderful coach. I believe seriously we didn't give him enough time. We didn't come to understand him very well. And also, when we have Ghanaian coaches, the sort of respect that a lot of us from the sports media give to those coaches, we don't give the same to our local coaches. We don't respect our own, we don't honor our own. And we tend to look down a lot more on our own. I've heard so many things said about local coaches. For example, that they take money from players, they take money from management and all this. I don't want to believe that. Because I believe that a good coach also wants results. Nobody will go out there and say, I'm a coach of the team and I'll pick the wrong player because of money. Every coach wanting to achieve result will pick the best player to play for him to win. So I don't believe anybody, because of money, would intentionally pick somebody who is not right just to go out there and say, I want to go and lose a match. So I believe that we should give the Ghanaian coaches opportunity. Today, I thank God that we have a lot of young Ghanaian guys coming up and venturing into coaching. You have the Siki Akunos, you have the Ibrahim Tankos, you have Mala Yayams, Mohamed Gago, Sudati Lamtes, and all these guys. You have Prayer Kunz and Felix Abuaje, George Lamte, our old ones like Salastete, Kwesi Appiah, and all the rest are there, Frimpong Mansour. I believe we should give them opportunity, invest in them, build a beehive of our play. And when these people, like Didi Kamara is doing, the Black Queens coach is also doing. All these are Ghanaian coaches. When we invest in them, then we have a spread of them. They will transfer knowledge to the teams at the local front, and we build up from there. Then we can, at the apex, we'll be able to have what is Ghanaian, an identity of our football. It becomes easier for us than to today being an expatriate who will be handling only the national team. So whilst we are teaching different methods, different applications at the local level in our various clubs, then we have a different identity and different knowledge too at the senior level. Sometimes it doesn't bring the synchronization that we have. We will not have a thread of identity in our play. And that, to some extent, is a worry to me.
Now, sir, many of your predecessors had serious difficulties with the Ghana Football Association. What is your own relationship with the GFA? Has it improved? Is it better than before? What is it?
Well, I wish I had avoided this question, because it's a serious issue, and maybe it's a hot issue. personally, as Nilanthi Vanderpoel, I don't have any problem with anybody at the FA, because to be frank with you, I don't really care who is the FA president. What is of interest to me is Ghana football. I've been in football throughout my life. One, as a player myself. Two, into management. And three, as a sports journalist. And I've come to say that football is part of my life. Maybe my blood is football. And I love football. I want to see football develop. I want football to see Ghana become one of the best places for football. And I think we have the potential. We will have different approaches to management of our teams, be it from the local, the club level to the national level. But I think that we cannot continue doing the same thing all the time and expect to achieve results. And we've been lucky too so far. I must say we've been lucky so far. Let me be frank with you. Since I became a minister, there are things that I've seen, things that I've heard, explanations that I have received to certain things that I think that as a country we've been very lucky. We've been very lucky that people have not wandered too much into those things to find out what is hidden. We've lived a sort of circus that I call the cow dung circus. The surface is dry, but beneath is all maggots. So I believe that we should change the way we do things. I don't think any personality at the football association or in football management in this country does not want anything good for the country. All of us want something good for the country. But you cannot be right all the time. And if you use a certain path in the past, and today trends have changed, the dynamics of the situation demands that we should really look at the way we have done things in the past. I don't think it should call for hatred, it should call for animosity. We should sit down and talk. I would say my relationship, personal relationship with the people at the FA is good. I have a lot of respect for all the members of the FA. I have personal, private relationship with people like the Vice President, George Afriye. Lawyer Kwekweya was my mate in the Infant Spim School. We slept almost on the same bed. We relate very well. A lot more of them have people I have respected since my days in football administration. So I don't have any problem with them. If I have problem, I have problem with the way some of the things are done. I have problems with some of the surrogates of the management of the Blasters who think that they could be the voice of their masters and go on offensive, attack ministers, hound the ministers out of office. And I have told myself, I will not allow anyone to hound me out. I was appointed by His Excellency President John Dramani Mahama because he has confidence in me to be able to deliver. I'm doing what, so far, I think is right for Ghana football, and I'll continue to do so. And if for that, one or two people think that I am not good enough, I think the best thing they have to do is to go back to the person who appointed me and tell him that I'm not doing what I'm supposed to do. But clearly, so far, I can say that we're on the right path. Though it's difficult, there are challenges. We're on the right path. I'm sure we'll be able to achieve the results I want. If tomorrow something unfortunately happened, it wouldn't be because of me. It would be because people don't want the right thing to be done. Master, let me say this. For example, as a country, we've made mistakes in the past. Master, the difficulty I've had is how to sustain, for example, issue of winning bonuses.
I was going to come to that.
It is just bonuses. Not sustainable as a country. It doesn't make sense because...
Bonuses to players or yes, bonuses to officials?
Bonuses to players and bonuses to officials. In the past, we've had bonuses for officials, which I think that it doesn't make sense. And I have said, and I will repeat, that I want anyone to convince me why I should pay a bonus to an official. Because I think that official already is benefiting in a way by a per diem, If he's part of the team, he has per diem. He gets a ticket toward the match, wherever it's been played. He sleeps in a hotel for free at the expense of the state. So why should that person be entitled to a bonus again? With the players, I think that I really seriously think whatever went into the decision to pay players that hooping amount of money as bonus in the past.
How hooping is the money?
We were paying our players $10,000 per match. I mean the Black Stars.
Winning bonus.
Bonuses. $10,000 per match. And if you consider that we have 23 players for every match, the Black Stars every year, possibly in a competition year, plays close to about 10 matches.
That's $2.3
million. Just for winning bonuses. If you put a match together, we spend close to $1 million on every Black Stars match. $1 million as a country. And seriously thinking, I, from my background, as a social democrat, I always say that if I consider the fact that there are communities, people, taxpaying Ghanaians who don't have access to water, electricity, roads, schools, and then we're spending $1 million just on one football match, I feel indicted.
But the winning bonuses were meant to be incentives. If you remove that, what is there as an incentive for players?
That is where I have come to. Nobody can convince me that the Portuguese players who are playing in the European Cup, the German players, the Wales players, and the French players who are playing there are not motivated, are not inspired to play for their nation. But they don't take the bonuses we take. Players, they are our players. They are all playing in the professional leagues. Somebody will say our players don't earn that much as them. But I also know our players who earn more than some of these players. So our players who earn more than some of these players, what is the motivation for them to play? And I believe money should not be the only thing that should motivate somebody, that should inspire somebody, that should urge somebody to want to contribute for his nation. Two, I know that playing for the national team is a great honor for our players. Two, it also adds value to them as footballers, as professional footballers. Three, in England, for example, if not featured for your country at least about 50%, you have problems with work permit in order to apply your trade in the English league. So to some extent, we are rather offering the players an opportunity, a platform for them to add to their market value. So they should rather appreciate this country more than we have to pay. Because the way we are doing it is like we are paying for the services of these players. But I don't think so. And the players individually, I believe so. If they have been conscientized and they've been made to understand why they are wearing the Ghana jersey right from the beginning, I think they understand. Because see, I will not resign this to only football. I believe as a Ghanaian, seriously speaking, what is lacking in our system, that always we want people to think that they are doing this country a favor by serving. We should be the other way around. That people should appreciate service to the nation. People should love to sacrifice, to work for this nation. Rather than the nation virtually like begging people to work for us. It's because whoever you are, it is this country who has given you the opportunity to get to the level you are, to be who you are. So often, other jurisdictions like other countries, people feel happy. Look, anybody who is called to wear the national jersey of South Africa worships the jersey. It's an honor. Recently, I had a chat with Edgar Davids, who played for the Dutch national team for close to 20 years. When he came in for the Stevie Appiah Peace Unity match. And he was shocked. He was shocked.
Hello, welcome back to Hot Issues. And we are talking sports, playing sports. and we're talking sports with the Minister for Youth and Sports. Now, sir, why is our national soccer team dominated by foreign players? What is the problem?
Well, it's simple. I sincerely believe that as a country, for the past 20 years, it's always been the case that almost all our players, we rather want to sell them outside. There are two sides to it. One, it gives the players opportunity to have improvement because of facilities outside. We don't have good facilities here, and it helps them. If you don't have good facilities, one, risk of injury is very high. Two, it reduces the rate of improvement in the player. Passing and all those things, it's affected. Two, it also brings revenue to the clubs so that they will have the opportunity of developing more talents. So you can see the attrition of our players into Europe and other places. So most of the time we have a lot more of the players outside. But I seriously also think that it's an African phenomenon. And that's why it got to a time when the CAF decided that we should also have a competition of national teams of players based within the continent. So that's why we also have the local blasters, as it's called. I have a problem with it because I think the blaster is a blaster. It doesn't matter whether the person plays in Europe or the person plays in our league. The blaster is a blaster. We have problems having an authentic Ghanaian domestic national team. Because the player who is playing a league today, who you have called to a national team, by the next 2-3 days, is playing somewhere in Europe. Because the team managers do not have the patience to let the player stay here. Two, it's also because the players are not paid well. If a player is playing in one of the topmost clubs in Ghana, and his take home a month is 300 cedis. 300 cedis. Less transportation. And that player is going to get an opportunity to play elsewhere in the world, where possibly he will be getting even $500 a month. That player will go. Excuse me to say, it will only be, excuse my language, a foolish person who will decide not to go.
But all of that is a reflection of the very low standards here. It's a reflection of the fact that we are not developing the game here and its facilities.
I agree.
So why don't we focus some attention on the development of the game and its facilities locally?
Yeah, for example, a lot more South African players are playing in their domestic league because they are paying well. They are developing their game better. Today, Sudan is even doing better. Kenya is doing well. Congo, for example, for some time now, a lot more of their players are playing at home. That's why their teams also perform better at the continental level. TP Mazembe and these other teams are paying very well. So I think that we must develop our game, one. We must support the local teams, develop infrastructure, two, and make sure that the human resource capacities at the local level is good. And if they are good, transfer of knowledge will be high. And when transfer of knowledge, it will make the game attractive and we shall get more money into the game. I also think that to some extent, people are not into football in this country because of what their interest is as to developing. All that they are doing is like poultry farmers.
Grooming players for
and
sale.
And for sale. So they look more at the business side of it and not the local or the national interest of it. A majority of the people who are into football, that's where their interest is. So they are not grooming for the national team and they are not grooming for you and I. All that they are doing is that they are grooming to sell.
What happened to the inter-school soccer competition, which produced fantastic players like Don Boate, like Nkansa, and so on? What happened to the inter-school
football competition? The problem we have in this country is that when me and you start talking about those days, people think that we are kolo. People think we are kolo. But even up to quite recently, the 80s, some of the best players we have had like the offenses and the farmers and Chehinis, Fimpo, Mansons, and the rest were all from the schools and colleges. The late George Atta, when I was in Sunyan, the late George Atta, Sarah Mensah, Poku Sampene, and all those things, Emmanuel Champo and the rest, were from the schools. To some extent, the problem is two-way. The Ghana Education Service is also a factor. Lack of what they call budgetary allocations has made it impossible for them to put money into sports the way it was being done in the past. Two, because the interest of people who are doing football is not the development of the player as an individual, but just for them to do business with the player. They don't also think about educating the player as a being. Because some of those people believe that when a player is highly educated, managing him is difficult. Because that player will be able to appreciate a lot of more things. So you will not have the opportunity to exploit him the way you want to exploit him. So it's a holistic thing that we have to look at. Thanks be to God. The little time we've been at the ministry, we've had chat with a lot of people. Today, through the intervention of the new owners of Home Finance Bank, for example, we are going to support schools, sports, at a basic level. I've had chat with GMPC, for example, who have agreed, in principle, to support the schools and colleges, football and sports. Mm. Milo is doing well with the schools under 13. We've seen wonderful talent. I've had a chat with Milo telling them that, look, it's not just a matter of organizing a competition in a year and leaving it to go. What is important is that these players that will come out, get a system for them to develop them. We also looking at how we could even get academies that we are having. As we have close to about 13 academies in the system. Why don't we have a national league for the academies too?
No, the football
academies.
Sporting.
Yeah. A lot of them are adding education, serious secular education to the football so that we can also have the opportunity for, so those players will be developed slowly.
My last question on soccer, I hope it is the last question. We understand that Sule Muntari is coming back to the Black Stars, or is on his way to the Black Stars. What kind of statement is that about discipline in the national team?
Well, I don't know about he coming back to the Black Stars because I don't have the capacity, I don't have the mandate to decide who plays in the Black Stars.
But you've heard.
Yeah, I've heard. And I think that to some extent, it is the right thing to do. This Ghanaian who has come to realize that what he acted in a way which was improper and has apologized and said that as a Ghanaian, I'm still available anytime you want my service. I think it's a good thing. So it is now left with a coach to say, I need him or I don't need him.
How do we instill discipline? How do we instill discipline? Some of the players appear to be highly disciplined.
I'm saying that the Ghanaian, I don't also want to say only the players were disciplined. Some of us administrators are also very indisciplined.
So how do we instill discipline?
I think administrators, players, whatever. When we all appreciate what is right to be done and we all do the right thing, the discipline will trickle down from the head down. Because if you look at the sequence, Sule Muntari didn't act well. But the whole scenario, everything that happened around the time, shows that one way or the other, individuals, a lot of individuals did not act well. Everybody was indisciplined. And to the extent that so much indiscipline has to assume out of the players towards even the minister. And I thought that that was not the right atmosphere. To instill discipline, administrators must first be disciplined. If, for example, we are in camp and we are not allowing the players to do certain things in camp, then we, the leadership, must first not do those things.
Now you, the leadership, you are not wearing boots, you are not playing.
No, but we set examples.
You are not wearing gloves to catch balls, so there are some things you can do which a goalkeeper cannot do.
Let me ask, if, for example, we are in a camp, those days we are talking about, for that discipline, Osagyefo Dr. Kwame Nkrumah will go and sleep with the players at the military academy training school. Jerry Rawlings did the same. Kutua Champon did the same. Why? General Kota, when he was in charge of sports, went to the camp, ate to the players, slept with them. Did this. Why? As leaders, we must set example. Set example. If we
but now you have a situation where some of the players actually take their wives to camp, or there have been one or two such reports.
Well, I haven't heard that. I have not seen that. And I would say, if the code says that you can have your spouse in camp, I don't have any problem. If that's the code.
Should they?
Well, some countries do it. Some countries do it. Some countries don't. Some countries, to create that family atmosphere for full concentration and focus, they do that. Others don't. Others will even buy telephone calls. So, for example, if we've taken a decision that players should not do calls in camp, and then to create a particular atmosphere, we've all agreed that we will not do calls. Even management will not do calls, and the management are doing calls. If you see a player doing a call, you have a problem. So I'm saying that the Sule issue, I don't know what happened. I don't want to. Sule was wrong. I agree. No matter what, he should have exercised restraint and show some respect to the GFA management member. But Sule says, I'm sorry. I believe in second chances. I believe I'm a Ghanaian. I believe that I've done a lot of mistakes in the
you
past.
You believe that he's sincere?
I believe so. I believe so because his colleagues, the players have all, some of them have all expressed, I think he's talked to
There's
them.
There's another case of a player, and Ghana scores a goal, and he whips up the flag of Israel.
That's all part of the indiscipline I talk about. That's part of indiscipline I talk about. For example, I just read the Japanese government saying that any member of the national team who will mime the national anthem instead of singing it will be dropped from the national team.
Yeah, I heard it yesterday.
Because that's all part of the culture I'm talking about. We should begin to make every Ghanaian understand that this nation is first. So when you're appointed to a position, you think first about the nation and not about yourself.
Okay, but that's all about soccer. What are you doing as a ministry to develop the other sports? And other sports, I mean, boxing, badminton, lawn tennis, golf,
yeah,
name it. Car racing, cycling, or what are you doing to develop all of these sports?
One, let me say this. In the past,
dummy or worry, and so on. Yeah.
In the past, what we have not done right is to see, when we say sports development, just as a matter of like, you know, but sports is done in three ways. We have the development aspect, we have the management aspect, we have the promotional aspect. In development, we have infrastructure development, we have the human development, and we have the human capacity development. Human capacity leading to the management, administrators, and everything. And that was why Osagyefo set up the Winneba Sports College. The Winneba Sports College was doing two things. One, building the technical capacity of people to go down there and teach. And also building the administrative capacity of people to manage sports. And then the government, in a way, was also taking care of infrastructure development. We've not done the best as a country when it comes to one, infrastructure development. And recently with the human development, we've totally killed it. Because we sat down and allowed Winneba Sports College to go. And so now we are no more training people. And let me give you one example. All some of the best coaches we've had in this country achieve what they achieve because of Winneba. So Osagyefo was not wrong when he took that decision. He foresaw that as a country, we have to build capacity of our people in order for us to be able to compete favorably across the globe. And those days, if you take the then East Germany and the then socialist countries like Poland, Hungary, the then Czechoslovakia, and all those places, they really invested in human capacity. Up to today, for example, Cuba has one of the best human resource capacity when it comes to sports, technical people. Recently, I had a chat. We've depended on Cuba for boxing coaches, amateur boxing. All the results we've achieved in the past were as a result of association with Cuban coaches. We desire to severe relationship with them, and we've dipped. So I have revived it to get assistance of Cuba again, so we can get a lot more. And they were not just training our boys, they were also transferring knowledge to Ghanaian coaches. So they've trained people like Isaac Asari, Iman Asari, I've forgotten the surname, Asari and the rest, who are coming up. I've had a chat with the Hungarian minister, prime minister, and also minister for sports. They are supporting us to develop our human capacities in the area of field events like javelin, discus, shot put, and the rest. We'll be sending some Ghanaians. We recently sent some people out to Czech Republic. We've also sent some people to Colombia. All these were supposed to come back and transfer knowledge. What we want to do first is to build a human capacity. As we continue to build infrastructure is capital intensive. So sometimes you may not have the resources to build the infrastructure to go. So what we are now trying to do is to inject private capital. And that is one of the areas Ghana we failed. Sports have transcended from being a social good to a business enterprise. You cannot see sports today as a social good anymore. It has gone beyond because the budget and the capital involved in sports infrastructure development especially cannot wholly be borne by governments anymore.
Welcome back to Hot Issues, and we're talking sports with the Honorable Minister of Sports, Nelante Vanderpoel. Now, sir, we've been crying about facilities, and we build quite a number of facilities. The problem is that we can't maintain them. What is the cause of the problem?
The cause of the problem, Master, is...
I heard the chief executive of the National Sports Authority complaining and throwing his hands in the sky and saying that they need to get private people to come and manage it. And my response was, what is he doing there?
A decision has been taken. Let me say this. His Excellency the President has taken a wonderful decision. He announced it when we commissioned the Keiko Stadium that we should submit a memorandum to Cabinet, and we have done that. Cabinet is going to take a decision. But even before that, in the sports bill before Parliament, the idea had been floated for us to disengage the management responsibility of the National Sports Authority of sporting facilities from them.
And give it to who?
In fact, what we are looking at getting Ghanaians qualified in facility management. The truth of the matter is that...
Why do you socialize the cost of providing infrastructure? And... and leave the profits to private people?
What we are talking...
These things were built with taxpayers' money.
We agree.
Are you saying that there's nobody in the public sector who can manage a stadium?
What we are doing basically is now... The new ones coming up, we're looking at PPPs. But the existing ones, what we are looking at is that, because for example, you have the expertise. So you come, we engage you, you manage in the facility, and from the revenue and the resources we get from the facility, we pay you.
Yeah, but before,
yeah,
you had the estate departments of the National Sports Council, and we're doing very well.
I won't sit here and accept that.
Since when did maintenance of stadia become a problem? Recently.
It is a canker that we are facing across the country. People are not managing national facilities very well. Because me and you were in this country. We used to have a state.
Is it because it forms part of the responsibility of the sports authority?
No.
Is that the reason? No. Is that the reason for the inefficiency?
Let's go back. Yeah. It's because of what I said earlier on. When we are giving people jobs in this country, we don't conscientize the people to believe, to accept the fact that the nation is doing them a favor.
But if you give it to private companies, and you don't conscientize them that we are doing them a favor, they will also run it underground.
You see, what we are looking at is not just a private, we are not giving up a private company. It's not just a matter of someone is there, come and take it. What I have said is that, for example, in Accra Sports Stadium, you are not just coming to say, I'm taking Accra Sports Stadium as it is to manage it and just give you money. You must give me a program as to what you are putting in.
Why can't you give the chief executive of the National Sports Authority the same responsibility for him to bring up a program for management?
Proven, they have proven to us that they are incapable of doing it.
Sack him and bring another person. Because there were others who were there who did it better. Ohinijan did it. So if somebody cannot do it, sack him.
Yeah, the issue has to do with that. We've seen it over the period. Like, for example, because let me be frank with you.
Mm-hmm.
It's not easy for me as a minister to say I'm sacking somebody. You know the civil service structure. I went to Kumasi Sports Stadium, an inspection. And then the estate manager, 330, 345, was drunk. Drunk.
What's the difficulty about sacking somebody who is drunk on the job? Show me the difficulty.
You, as a minister, the only thing you can do is to revert to the chief executive
and say,
take an action against this person.
Yes.
As I say today. So he has to go to discipline committee, it has to go to a board, it has to go to a this.
No problem. Let it go through, but let the guy get sacked.
So the guy sits there and continually is going through the process. So if for 2 years the board has not taken a decision, that person is saddled with the responsibility of maintaining something.
Change the board.
That attitude.
Change the board. If the board doesn't function, change it.
I wish.
Privatization is not a solution to everything.
I wish that me and you will have that easy to be very revolutionary in our approach to maintaining discipline and order within our system. But sometimes the structure we have in the system, the institutional structures make it incapable. I wish that if I get to a ministry and somebody is doing the things the way it should go, I have the capacity, I have the power to sack the person.
I wish I have the capacity, just as the president has the capacity to sack me tomorrow if I don't do well. You have.
Yeah, you initiate action. Yeah. And I said that you don't have total control over even that action you initiate.
But if you bring the private sector to take over the management,
and the person that's not well, I have every right to take the person, sack the person, abrogate the contract.
Why can't you do it now? If there's an estate manager of a private company who gets drunk at 9 a.m., it's not the same as
the management company that is saddled with the responsibility will take a decision to sack that person in the next moment.
Is that the problem?
I think it's human factor plays a huge role in this. Because if somebody sits there and a person thinks at the end of the month, country broke or country no broke, I will be paid. It's different from somebody saying that I will be paid according to my productivity. I believe that even we government workers, public servants, should be given what I call benchmarks to achieve in order to derive our revenue, to derive our pay, our allowances. I believe so. Because from my background, I don't see why I feel guilty if at any amount I value myself and see that I have not worked enough to derive that amount of money as pay. That is my training. That is what I believe in. And I believe we have so many people in the system to think that way. Two, let me say this. One of the issues too has to do with the fact that the sports authority as it is today and the legal regime they operate under has tied their hands a little bit in being ingenious and creative in the way they operate. So there's a need for us to open up a little, create the flexibility for them to be able to be innovative. The other issue has to do with, for example, people's own marketing skills. The ministry, as it is today, do not even have a marketing department. The sports authority hasn't got any effective marketing department. This facility, as Accra Sports, you know, Kumasi and the rest, has not been packaged. It's not been marketed for people to. We have a lot of spaces there for shops, for offices, for things. Nobody goes there. Nobody is going. At the end of the month, they will get their pay. But if you are going to be paid according to the revenue you derive, you will then be forced to work harder, do more in order to drive the money so that you will be paid out of it.
One of your predecessors, Malam Issa, spoke about a demon in the ministry. Perhaps, maybe later, mafia and so on. Is it still there?
Well, I thank God that...
Or it's dead.
I thank God that maybe that demon or that mafia is exorcised. So far, I wouldn't say no. I thank God, I appreciate God, the fact that I have a new team I'm working with. A lot of the people at the ministry, the one who has been there longest is 4 years. Fresh people, new people, and I've built relationships to let them understand that it is the responsibility of you and I today to change the perception of people out there that you are a mafia, you are here, you are a thief. You. If a minister talks, you just want to hand the minister out and bring down the minister. And so we together working as a team. And I appreciate all the workers at the ministry today. Everybody is ready to kill himself or herself a little bit for us to achieve results. And they are not happy with the sort of mindset out there because it follows them. Some of the people who have been there before, that sort of perception is following them wherever they've gone to. And so those people there now are not happy and they want to change. And the ministry has changed. There's a new breath of life. Our only problem is that we don't have the sort of financial muscle to be able to undertake all the good things the ministry want to do. The ministry is not only sports. We're supposed to control all the 11 youth development leadership training schools across the country. It was not for easy that those things were created. Even before somebody becomes a sports person, that person as a youth need to be developed. So you need to develop that person consciously, psychologically, mentally, before the person engages in sports. So when a person is now doing the sports, the person understands why he is doing that sports for this country. But what we do is that we let the people engage in sports before we try to build their conscience up. So the youth leadership training centers are supposed to be the centers for building people up, changing people's mindset, conscientizing, indoctrinating people to build them up to want to do service to this country. Unfortunately, we've allowed all those things to die. So,
but the National Youth Authority has itself become very, very weak.
Yes.
As compared to the National Youth Council, which existed from 1974.
I agree with you, but that is all after the fact that if they have the resources, they draw programs, they can't embark on any of the programs. The National Sports, for instance, as I'm talking to you now, I'm having nightmares on how to raise the close to $140,000+ that we will need to send our team to the Olympic Games. It's not easy. I'm having sleepless nights.
And thank you very much for coming.
I hope we'll have more time to talk about the youth. Well, this one is
yours. There'll be a lot of time, there'll be a lot of time. But thank you very much for coming to the studio.
It's a pleasure.
Well, viewers, we've been talking to Honorable Nilante Vanderpoel, Minister of Youth and Sports. And as I always say, the best is on this channel.
Brought to you by Gassam Cement and supported by 3FM 92.7 Accra.